Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Cosmic Game, Explorations of the Frontiers of Human Consciousness, by Stanislav Grof. Narrated by Michael Butler Murray. Publisher's Note: This audiobook refers to figures included in the print and ebook editions of the book. 1. Introduction. The most beautiful experience we can have is the mysterious. He to whom this emotion is a stranger, who can no longer pause to wonder and stand rapt in awe, is as good as dead. Albert Einstein. Use the light that dwells within you to regain your natural clarity of sight. Lao Tzu. This book addresses some of the most fundamental questions of existence that human beings have been asking since time immemorial. How did our universe come into being? Is the world we live in merely a product of mechanical processes involving inanimate, inert, and reactive matter? Do we have to assume the existence of superior cosmic intelligence responsible for the creation and evolution of the cosmos? Can material reality be explained solely in terms of natural laws? Or does it involve forces and principles that elude such descriptions? How can we come to terms with such dilemmas as finiteness of time and space versus eternity and infinity? What is the source of order, form, and meaning in the universe? What is the relationship between life and matter, and between consciousness and the brain? Many of the issues that we will explore in this book have great relevance for everyday existence. How should we understand the apparent conflict between good and evil, the mystery of karma and reincarnation, and the problem of the meaning of human life? These are not questions that are usually asked in the context of psychiatric practice or psychological research. And yet, in my work as a psychiatrist, these issues emerged quite spontaneously and with extraordinary urgency in the minds of many of the people with whom I have worked. The reason for this is the unusual field of study that has been the main focus of my interest during the 40 years of my professional life: research of non-ordinary states of consciousness. This interest began quite unexpectedly and in a very dramatic way in 1956, only a few months after my graduation from medical school, when I volunteered for an experiment with LSD in the psychiatric department of the School of Medicine in Prague, Czechoslovakia. This experience profoundly influenced my personal and professional life and provided the inspiration for my lifelong commitment to consciousness research. Although I have been interested in the entire spectrum of non-ordinary states of consciousness, I have had most personal experience with psychedelic research, with therapeutic work involving individuals undergoing spontaneous psycho-spiritual crises, spiritual emergencies, and with holotropic breathwork, a method that I have developed jointly with my wife Christina. In psychedelic therapy, the non-ordinary states of consciousness are induced by chemical means. In spiritual emergencies, they develop spontaneously for unknown reasons in the middle of everyday life. And in holotropic breathwork, they are facilitated by a combination of faster breathing, evocative music, and a specific form of focused body work. In this book, I will be drawing on all these three areas, since the insights from all of them are very similar, if not identical. Consciousness research and perennial philosophy. In my previous publications, I have described the important implications of systematic study of non-ordinary states of consciousness for the understanding of emotional and psychosomatic disorders, and for psychotherapy. This book has a much larger and general focus. It explores the extraordinary philosophical, metaphysical, and spiritual insights that have emerged in the course of this work. The experiences and observations from this research have revealed important aspects and dimensions of reality that are usually hidden from our everyday awareness. Throughout centuries, these experiences and the realms of existence they disclose have been described in the context of spiritual philosophies and mystical traditions, such as Vedanta, Hinayana, and Mahayana Buddhism, Taoism, Sufism, Gnosticism, Christian mysticism, Kabbalah, and many other sophisticated spiritual systems. The findings of my research and contemporary consciousness research in general essentially confirm and support the position of these ancient teachings. They are thus in radical conflict with the most fundamental assumptions of materialistic science concerning consciousness, human nature, and the nature of reality. They clearly indicate that consciousness is not a product of the brain, but a primary principle of existence, and that it plays a critical role in the creation of the phenomenal world. This research also radically changes our conception of the human psyche. It shows that, in its farthest reaches, the psyche of each of us is essentially commensurate with all of existence, and ultimately, identical with the cosmic creative principle itself. This conclusion, while seriously challenging the worldview of modern technological societies, is in far-reaching agreement with the image of reality found in the great spiritual and mystical traditions of the world, which the Anglo-American writer and philosopher Aldous Huxley referred to as the perennial philosophy. Modern consciousness research has generated important data that support the basic tenets of the perennial philosophy. It has revealed a grand, purposeful design underlying all of creation and has shown that all of existence is permeated by superior intelligence. In the light of these new discoveries, spirituality is affirmed as an important and legitimate endeavor in human life, since it reflects a critical dimension of the human psyche and of the universal scheme of things. The mystical traditions and spiritual philosophies of the past have often been dismissed and even ridiculed for being irrational and unscientific. This is an uninformed judgment that is unwarranted and unjustified. Many of the great spiritual systems are products of centuries of in-depth exploration of the human psyche and consciousness that in many ways resembles scientific research. These systems offer detailed instructions concerning the methods of inducing spiritual experiences on which they base their philosophical speculations. They have systematically collected data drawn from these experiences and subjected them to collective consensus validation, usually over a period of many centuries. These are exactly the stages necessary for achieving valid and reliable knowledge in any area of scientific endeavor. It is very exciting that the claims of various schools of perennial philosophy can now be supported by data from modern consciousness research. The approaches to self-exploration that make this modern validation possible, as they are described in this book, do not require the same degree of commitment and personal sacrifice as the ancient spiritual practices. They are more accessible and practical for Westerners who are trapped in the complexity of modern life. The use of psychedelics has been compromised by widespread unsupervised experimentation and is at present seriously barred by a host of administrative and legal restrictions. However, holotropic breathwork is a method that is available for all those interested in exploring the validity of the insights described in this book. The experiences from our workshops conducted all over the world and the feedback from several hundred people who have completed our training and facilitate holotropic breathwork sessions themselves have convinced me that the observations I have described in this book are fully replicable. Holotropic states of consciousness. Before we begin to explore the spiritual and philosophical insights from my work, I would like to clarify in which sense I will be using in this book the term non-ordinary states of consciousness. My primary interest is to focus on experiences that represent a useful source of data about the human psyche and the nature of reality, particularly those that reveal various aspects of the spiritual dimension of existence. I would also like to examine the healing, transformative, and evolutionary potential of these experiences. For this purpose, the term non-ordinary states of consciousness is too general, since it includes a wide range of conditions that are not interesting or relevant from this point of view. Consciousness can be profoundly changed by a variety of pathological processes, by cerebral traumas, by intoxications with poisons, by infections, or by degenerative and circulatory processes in the brain. Such conditions can certainly result in profound mental changes that would be included in the category of non-ordinary states of consciousness. However, they cause trivial deliria or organic psychoses, states that are very important clinically, but are not relevant for our discussion. People suffering from delirious states are typically disoriented. They might be confused to such a degree that they do not know who and where they are, and what month or year it is. They typically show a disturbance of intellectual functions and have subsequent amnesia for the experiences they have had. I will, therefore, narrow our discussion to a large and important subgroup of non-ordinary states of consciousness for which contemporary psychiatry does not have a specific term, because I am convinced that they deserve to be distinguished from the rest and placed into a special category. I have coined for them the name holotropic. This composite word literally means oriented toward wholeness, or moving in the direction of wholeness, from the Greek holos, whole, and tropein, moving toward or in the direction of something. The full meaning of this term and the justification for its use will become clear later in this book. It suggests that in our everyday state of consciousness, we are not really whole. We are fragmented and identify with only a small fraction of who we really are. Holotropic states are characterized by a specific transformation of consciousness associated with perceptual changes in all sensory areas, intense and often unusual emotions, and profound alterations in the thought processes. They are also usually accompanied by a variety of intense psychosomatic manifestations and unconventional forms of behavior. Consciousness is changed qualitatively in a very profound and fundamental way, but, unlike in the delirant conditions, it is not grossly impaired. In holotropic states, we experience intrusion of other dimensions of existence that can be very intense and even overwhelming. However, at the same time, we typically remain fully oriented and do not completely lose touch with everyday reality. We experience simultaneously two very different realities. Extraordinary changes in sensory perception represent a very important and characteristic aspect of holotropic states. With the eyes open, we typically experience profound changes in the shapes and colors of the environment. When we close our eyes, we can be flooded with images drawn from our personal history and from the collective unconscious. We can also have visions portraying various aspects of nature, of the cosmos, or of the mythological realms. This can be accompanied by a wide range of experiences engaging other senses, various sounds, physical sensations, smells, and tastes. The emotions associated with holotropic states cover a very broad spectrum that extends far beyond the limits of our everyday experience. They range from feelings of ecstatic rapture, heavenly bliss, and peace that passeth all understanding, to episodes of abysmal terror, overpowering anger, utter despair, consuming guilt, and other forms of extreme emotional suffering. The intensity of these agonizing experiences can match the descriptions of the tortures of hell in some of the great religions of the world. The physical sensations that accompany these states are similarly polarized, depending on the content of the experience. It can be a sense of extraordinary health and well-being, optimal physiological functioning, and orgastic sexual sensations of enormous intensity, but also extreme discomfort, such as excruciating pains, pressures, nausea, or feelings of suffocation. A particularly interesting aspect of holotropic states is their effect on the thought processes. The intellect is not impaired, but it operates in a way that is significantly different from its everyday functioning. While we might not be able to rely on these states in our judgment in ordinary practical matters, we can be literally flooded with remarkable new information on a variety of subjects. We can reach profound psychological insights concerning our personal history, unconscious dynamics, emotional difficulties, and interpersonal problems. We can also experience extraordinary revelations concerning various aspects of nature and the cosmos that transcend our educational and intellectual background. By far, the most interesting insights that become available in holotropic states revolve around philosophical, metaphysical, and spiritual issues. Exploration of these insights is the main focus of this book. Philosophical and Spiritual Insights from Holotropic States. The content of holotropic states of consciousness is often philosophical and mystical. In these episodes, we can experience sequences of psycho-spiritual death and rebirth, or feelings of oneness with other people, nature, the universe, and God. We might uncover what seems to be memories from other incarnations, encounter powerful archetypal beings, communicate with discarnate entities, and visit numerous mythological domains. The rich spectrum of these states also includes out-of-body experiences during which the disembodied consciousness maintains the capacity of optical perception and can accurately observe from unusual angles and distances the events in the immediate environment of the body, as well as in various remote locations. Holotropic experiences can be induced by a variety of ancient and aboriginal techniques, technologies of the sacred. These procedures combine in various ways: drumming, rattling, sounds of bells or gongs, chanting, rhythmic dancing, changes of breathing, and cultivation of special forms of awareness. They might include extended social and sensory isolation, fasting, sleep deprivation, dehydration, and even drastic physical interventions, such as bloodletting, powerful laxatives and purgatives, and infliction of severe pain. A particularly effective technology of the sacred has been ritual use of psychedelic plants and substances. These mind-altering techniques have played a critical role in the ritual and spiritual history of humanity. Induction of holotropic states has been absolutely essential for shamanism, rites of passage, and other ceremonies of native cultures. It also represented the key element of the ancient mysteries of death and rebirth that were conducted in different parts of the world, and particularly flourished in the Mediterranean area. Holotropic experiences have been equally important for various mystical branches of the great religions of the world. These esoteric traditions have developed a variety of technologies of the sacred, specific methods of inducing such experiences. Here belong various forms of yoga, meditation and concentration techniques, multivocal chanting, whirling of the dervishes, ascetic practices, the Christian hesychasm, or Jesus prayer, and many others. In modern times, the spectrum of mind-altering techniques has been considerably enriched. The clinical approaches include the use of pure alkaloids from psychedelic plants or synthetic psychedelic substances, as well as powerful forms of experiential psychotherapy, such as hypnosis, primal therapy, rebirthing, and holotropic breathwork. The most popular of the laboratory methods of inducing holotropic states has been sensory deprivation, an approach based on various degrees of reduction of sensory stimuli. Another well-known method is biofeedback, which makes it possible to use the information about the changes in one's brainwaves as a guideline to specific states of consciousness. Many special electronic devices use the principle of entrainment, or driving, of the brainwaves by various acoustic and optical stimuli. It is important to emphasize that episodes of holotropic states of varying depth and duration can also occur spontaneously, without any specific identifiable cause, and often against the will of the people involved. Since modern psychiatry does not differentiate between mystical or spiritual states and psychotic episodes, People experiencing these states are often diagnosed as mentally ill, hospitalized, and subjected to routine suppressive pharmacological treatment. My wife Christina and I have suggested that many of these states are actually psycho-spiritual crises or spiritual emergencies. If they are properly understood and individuals undergoing them are supported by experienced facilitators, episodes of this kind can result in psychosomatic healing, spiritual opening, positive personality transformation, and consciousness evolution. Ancient wisdom and modern science. As we have heard from the previous description, holotropic experiences are the common denominator in many procedures that have, throughout centuries, shaped the ritual, spiritual, and cultural life of many human groups. They have been the main source of cosmologies, mythologies, philosophies, and religious systems describing the spiritual nature of the cosmos and of existence. They are the key for understanding the spiritual life of humanity, from shamanism and sacred ceremonies of Aboriginal tribes to the great religions of the world. But most important, they provide invaluable practical guidelines for a rich and satisfying life strategy that makes it possible to realize to the fullest our creative potential. For all these reasons, it is important that Western scientists free themselves from their materialistic prejudices and subject holotropic states to unbiased, systematic research. I have been deeply interested in all the categories of holotropic states of consciousness mentioned before, and have had important personal experiences in many of them. However, as I have mentioned earlier, most of my professional work has been in the areas of psychedelic therapy, holotropic breathwork, and spiritual emergency. Although the experiences observed in these three situations differ in terms of the triggers that initiate them, they seem to be remarkably similar in terms of their experiential content and of the spiritual and philosophical insights that they convey. During my professional career, I have personally conducted over 4,000 psychedelic sessions with such substances as LSD, psilocybin, mescaline, dipropyl tryptamine, DPT, and methylene dioxyamphetamine, MDA, and had access to over 2,000 sessions conducted by my colleagues. A significant proportion of these sessions involved psychiatric patients suffering from various forms of emotional and psychosomatic disorders, such as depression, psychoneurosis, psychosomatic disorders, alcoholism, and narcotic drug addiction. Another large group consisted of patients suffering from various forms of cancer, most of them terminal. In this study, the objective was not only to relieve the emotional distress and severe physical pain associated with this illness, but also to offer these patients an opportunity to achieve mystical states in order to alleviate their fear of death, change their attitude toward it, and transform their experience of dying. The remaining subjects were normal volunteers, such as psychiatrists, psychologists, social workers, clergy, artists, and scientists from various disciplines who volunteered for psychedelic sessions because they sought understanding and insight. The breathing sessions were conducted in the context of a long-term training program of professionals and of experiential workshops with a broad cross-section of the general population. Over the years, my wife Christina and I have supervised over 30,000 holotropic sessions, mostly carried out in groups, only exceptionally on an individual basis. Besides the experimentation with psychedelics and with the holotropic breathwork, I have also worked with many individuals undergoing spontaneous psycho-spiritual crises. This occurred occasionally as part of my personal and professional life, and was not carried out systematically as a specific project. In writing this book, I used the records that I had amassed during more than 40 years of work in the field of consciousness studies. I have focused specifically on those parts of the records that described experiences and observations related to basic ontological and cosmological questions. To my surprise, What emerged from these accounts of holotropic states was a comprehensive and logically consistent alternative to the understanding of human nature and of existence that has been formulated by materialistic science and that represents the official ideology of the Western industrial civilization. People who experience holotropic states and integrate them effectively do not develop idiosyncratic delusional worldviews representing disjointed distortions of objective reality. They discover various partial aspects of a grand vision of a universe that is created and permeated by superior cosmic intelligence. In the last analysis, this ensouled cosmos is commensurate with their own psyche and consciousness. These insights show a remarkable similarity to the understanding of reality that has repeatedly emerged, often quite independently, throughout history in different parts of the world. In many variations, this vision of reality has been shared by all the people who have had the opportunity to complement their everyday experience of material reality with insights from holotropic states of consciousness. This finding brings good news to the millions of Westerners and people in technologized societies who have had various forms of holotropic experiences and were unable to integrate them with the belief system of their mainstream cultures. Because of this discrepancy, many of them questioned their own sanity or had their sanity questioned by others, including the mental health professionals from whom they sought advice or to whom they were brought against their will. The study of holotropic states vindicates these people and reveals the shortcomings of contemporary psychiatry. It shows an urgent need for a radical revision and revisioning of our understanding of human nature and of the nature of reality. As the revolutionary advances of various disciplines of modern science continue to lift the spell of the outdated materialistic worldview, we begin to see the outlines of a new comprehensive understanding of ourselves, nature, and the universe. It is increasingly clear that this emerging alternative approach to existence will integrate science and spirituality and introduce important elements of the ancient wisdom into our technological world. Even at present, we have much more than just a disjointed mosaic of revolutionary theories and a vague outline for such a vision. Irvin Laszlo has already provided a brilliant synthesis of the most important theoretical breakthroughs in various fields of modern science. Ken Wilber has formulated an extraordinary interdisciplinary framework that provides the necessary philosophical foundations for such integral understanding of reality. Clearly, when this new vision of the cosmos is completed, it will not be a simple return to pre-scientific understanding of reality, but an overarching creative synthesis of the best of the past and the present. A worldview preserving all the achievements of modern science and, at the same time, reintroducing into the Western civilization the spiritual value that it has lost, could have profound influence on our individual as well as collective life. I firmly believe that the experiences and observations from holotropic states explored in this book will be an integral part of this exciting new image of reality and of human nature that is now painfully being born. 2. Cosmos, Consciousness, and Spirit. As we progress and awaken to the soul in us and things, we shall realize that there is consciousness also in the plant, in the metal, in the atom, in electricity, in everything that belongs to physical nature. Sri Aurobindo, The Synthesis of Yoga. The difference between most people and myself is that for me, the dividing walls are transparent. C.G. Jung, Memories, Dreams, Reflections. The Worldview of Materialistic Science. According to Western science, the universe is an immensely complex assembly of material particles that has essentially created itself. Life, consciousness, and intelligence are insignificant and more or less accidental latecomers on the cosmic scene. These three aspects of existence allegedly appeared in a negligible portion of an immense cosmos after billions of years of evolution of matter. Life owes its origin to random chemical processes in the primeval ocean that gathered atoms and inorganic molecules into organic compounds. The organic material then acquired during further evolution the capacity for self-preservation, reproduction, and cellular organization. The unicellular organisms assembled into larger and larger multicellular life forms, and eventually developed into the rich panoply of species inhabiting this earth, including Homo sapiens. We are told that consciousness emerged in late stages of this evolution out of the complexity of the physiological processes in the central nervous system. It is a product of the brain, and as such, it is confined to the inside of our skull. From this perspective, consciousness and intelligence are functions that are limited to human beings and higher animals. They certainly do not and cannot exist independently of biological systems. According to this way of understanding reality, the content of our psyche is more or less limited to the information we have received through our sensory organs from the external world since the time we were born. Here, Western scientists basically agree with the old saying of the British empiricist school of philosophy: there is nothing in the intellect that was not previously in a sense organ. This position, first articulated by John Locke in the 18th century, naturally excludes the possibility of extrasensory perception, ESP, access to information of any kind that is not mediated by the senses, such as telepathy, clairvoyance, or out-of-body experiences with accurate perception of remote locations. In addition, the nature and extent of our sensory input is determined by the physical characteristics of the environment and by the physiological properties and constraints of our senses. For example, we cannot see objects if we are separated from them by a solid wall. We lose from our view a ship that passes beyond the horizon, and we are unable to observe the other side of the moon. Similarly, we cannot hear the sounds if the acoustic waves created by an external event do not reach our ears with sufficient intensity. When we are in San Francisco, we cannot see and hear what our friends are doing in New York City, unless, of course, this perception is mediated by some modern technological inventions, such as television or telephone. Conceptual challenges from modern consciousness research. The experiences in non-ordinary states of consciousness seriously challenge such narrow understanding of the potential of the human psyche and of the limits of our perception. What we can experience in these states is not limited to memories from our life after we were born, and to the Freudian individual unconscious, as materialistic scientists have taught us to believe. Holotropic experiences reach far beyond the boundaries of what the Anglo-American writer and philosopher, Alan Watts, facetiously called the skin-encapsulated ego. They can take us into vast territories of the psyche, as yet uncharted by Western psychologists and psychiatrists. In an effort to describe and classify all the phenomena that became available in holotropic states, I have sketched a new map of human experience that expands the conventional understanding of the psyche. In this context, I will only briefly outline the basic features of this new cartography. A more detailed description can be found in my earlier books. To account for all the experiences that can occur in holotropic states, I had to radically expand the current Western understanding of the psyche by adding two large domains. The first of these is a repository of intense physical sensations and emotions linked to the trauma of birth, such as extreme physical pains in various parts of the body, feelings of suffocation, experience of vital anxiety, hopelessness, and intense rage. In addition, this domain also contains a rich spectrum of corresponding symbolic images revolving around the issues of birth, death, sex, and violence. I refer to this level of the psyche as perinatal because of its association with biological birth. From the Greek, peri, around or near, and the Latin natalis, pertaining to childbirth. I will return to this topic later in the chapter exploring the spiritual dimensions of birth, sex, and death. The second additional domain of the psyche included in my cartography can be referred to as transpersonal, since its basic characteristic is the experience of transcending the usual personal limitations of the body and the ego. Transpersonal experiences vastly expand the sense of personal identity by including elements of the external world and other dimensions of reality. One important category of transpersonal experience involves, for example, authentic experiential identification with other people, animals, plants, and various other aspects of nature and the cosmos. Another large group of transpersonal phenomena can be described in terms of what the Swiss psychiatrist C.G. Jung, 1959, called the collective unconscious. This vast repository of ancestral, racial, and collective memories contains the entire historical and cultural heritage of humanity. It also harbors primordial organizing principles that Jung called archetypes. According to him, the archetypes govern the processes in our psyche, as well as the events in the world at large. They also are the creative force behind the infinitely rich imaginal world of the psyche, with its pantheons of mythological realms and beings. In holotropic states, the contents of the collective unconscious become available for conscious experience. Careful study of the perinatal and transpersonal experiences shows that the boundaries between the individual human psyche and the rest of the cosmos are ultimately arbitrary and can be transcended. This work brings strong evidence suggesting that, in the last analysis, each of us is commensurate with the totality of existence. What it means practically is that anything that we would, in our everyday state of consciousness, perceive as an object can be also encountered as a corresponding subjective experience when we are in a holotropic state. In addition to all the elements of the material world throughout the entire range of space-time, we can also experience various aspects of other dimensions of reality, such as archetypal beings and mythological domains of the collective unconscious. In holotropic states, we can experience in remarkable detail all the stages of our biological birth, memories of prenatal existence, and even a cellular record of our conception. Transpersonal experience can bring forth episodes from the lives of our immediate or remote ancestors, or take us into the realm of the racial and collective unconscious. They can provide access to episodes that appear to be memories from previous incarnations, or even vestiges from the lives of our animal ancestors. We might experience full conscious identification with other people, groups of people, animals, plants, and even inorganic objects and processes. During such experiences, we can gain entirely new accurate information about various aspects of the universe, including the data that we could not have possibly acquired in our present lifetime through the ordinary channels. When we have experienced to sufficient depth these dimensions that are hidden to our everyday perception, we typically undergo profound changes in our understanding of existence and the nature of reality. The most fundamental metaphysical insight we obtain is the realization that the universe is not an autonomous system that has evolved as a result of mechanical interplay of material particles. We find it impossible to take seriously the basic assumption of materialistic science, which asserts that the history of the universe is merely the history of evolving matter. We have directly experienced the divine, sacred, or numinous dimensions of existence in a very profound and compelling way. The ensouled universe. Following powerful transpersonal experiences, our worldview typically expands to include some elements of the cosmologies of various native peoples and ancient cultures. This development is completely independent of our intelligence, educational background, or profession. Authentic and convincing experiences of conscious identification with animals, plants, and even inorganic materials and processes make it easy to understand the beliefs of animistic cultures that see the entire universe as being ensouled. From their perspective, not only all the animals, but also the trees, the rivers, the mountains, the sun, the moon, and the stars appear to be sentient beings. The following experience shows how it is possible in holotropic states of consciousness to experience inorganic objects as divine entities. It involves John, an intelligent and educated American, who had a powerful experience of loss of his everyday identity and conscious identification with a granite mountain while camping with his friends at a high altitude in Sierra Nevada. I was resting on a large flat slab of granite with my feet immersed in a pristine creek cascading down the mountain. I was basking in the sun, absorbing its rays with my whole being. As I was getting more and more relaxed, I felt deep peace, deeper than I could ever imagine. Time was progressively slowing down until it finally seemed to stop. I felt the touch of eternity. Gradually, I lost the sense of boundaries and merged with the granite mountain. All my inner turmoil and chatter quieted down and was replaced with absolute stillness. I felt that I had arrived. I was in a state of ultimate rest, where all my desires and needs were satisfied and all questions answered. Suddenly, I realized that this profound, unfathomable peace had something to do with the nature of granite. As incredible as it might seem, I felt that I became the consciousness of granite. I suddenly understood why the Egyptians made granite sculptures of deities, and why the Hindus saw the Himalayas as the reclining figure of Shiva. It was the imperturbable state of consciousness that they worshipped. It takes tens of millions of years before even the surface of granite is broken by the assaults of weather. During that time, the mercurial organic world undergoes countless changes. Species originate, exist, and get extinct. Dynasties are founded, rule, and are replaced by others. And thousands of generations play out their silly dramas. The granite mountain stands there like a majestic witness, like a deity, immovable and untouched by anything that happens. The world of deities and demons. Holotropic states of consciousness can also provide deep insights into the worldview of the cultures that believe that the cosmos is populated by mythological beings, and that it is governed by various blissful and wrathful deities. In these states, we can gain direct experiential access to the world of gods, demons, legendary heroes, superhuman entities, and spirit guides. We can visit the domain of mythological realities, fantastic landscapes, and abodes of the beyond. The imagery of such experiences can be drawn from the collective unconscious and can feature mythological figures and themes from any culture in the entire history of humanity. Deep personal experiences of this realm help us realize that the images of the cosmos found in pre-industrial societies are not based on superstition or primitive magical thinking, but on direct experiences of alternate realities. A particularly convincing proof of the authenticity of these experiences is the fact that, like other transpersonal phenomena, they can bring us new and accurate information about various archetypal beings and realms. The nature, scope, and quality of this information often by far surpasses our previous intellectual knowledge concerning the respective mythologies. Observations of this kind led C.G. Jung to the assumption that, besides the individual unconscious, as described by Sigmund Freud, we also have a collective unconscious that connects us with the entire cultural heritage of all humanity. I will describe here as an illustration one of the most interesting experiences of this kind I have observed during the years of my work with holotropic states of consciousness. It involved Otto, one of my clients in Prague, whom I treated for depression and pathological fear of death, thanatophobia. In one of his psychedelic sessions, he experienced a powerful sequence of psycho-spiritual death and rebirth. As the experience was culminating, he had a vision of an ominous entrance into the underworld, guarded by a terrifying pig goddess. At this point, he suddenly felt an urgent need to draw a specific geometrical design. Although I generally asked my clients to stay during their sessions in a reclining position, with the eyes closed, and keep the experiences internalized, at this point Otto opened his eyes, sat up, and urgently asked me to bring him some sheets of paper and drawing utensils. He drew an entire series of complex abstract patterns, and with great dissatisfaction and despair, he kept impulsively tearing and crumpling these intricate designs as soon as he finished them. He was very dissatisfied with his drawings and was getting increasingly frustrated because he was not able to get it right. When I asked him what he was trying to do, he was not able to explain it to me. He said that he simply felt an irresistible compulsion to draw these geometrical patterns and was convinced that drawing the right kind of design was somehow a necessary condition for a successful completion of his session. The theme clearly had a strong emotional charge for Otto, and it seemed important to understand it. At that time, I was still under a strong influence of my Freudian training, and I tried my best to identify the unconscious motives for this strange behavior by using the method of free associations. We spent much time on this task, but without much success. The entire sequence simply did not make any sense. Eventually, the process moved to other areas, and I stopped thinking about this situation. The entire episode had remained for me completely mysterious until many years later, when I moved to the United States. During my stay in Baltimore, a friend of mine suggested that Joseph Campbell might be interested in the implications of my research for mythology and offered to arrange a meeting with him. After a few initial encounters, we became good friends, and he played a very important role in my personal and professional life. Joseph has been considered by many to be the greatest mythologist of the 20th century, and possibly of all times. His intellect was remarkable, and his knowledge of world mythology truly encyclopedic. He had a keen interest in the research of non-ordinary states of consciousness, which he considered to be very relevant for the study of mythology. We had many fascinating discussions over the years, during which I shared with him various observations of obscure archetypal experiences from my work that I was not able to understand. In most instances, Joseph had no difficulties identifying the cultural sources of the symbolism involved. During one of these discussions, I remembered that episode and shared it with him. "How fascinating," said Joseph, without any hesitation. "It was clearly the cosmic Mother Night of Death, the devouring mother goddess of the Malekulans in New Guinea." He then continued to tell me that the Malekulans believed they would encounter this deity during the journey of the dead. She had the form of a frightening female figure with distinct pig features. According to the Malekulan tradition, she sat at the entrance into the underworld and guarded an intricate sacred labyrinthine design. The Malekulans had an elaborate system of rituals that involved breeding and sacrificing pigs. This complex ritual activity was aimed at overcoming the dependency on their human mothers and eventually on the devouring mother goddess. The Malekulans spent an enormous amount of time practicing the art of the labyrinth drawing, since its mastery was considered essential for a successful journey to the beyond. Joseph, with his lexical knowledge, was able to solve an important part of this puzzle that I had come across during my research. The remaining question, that even he was not able to answer, was why my client had to encounter specifically this Malekulan deity at that particular time of his therapy. However, the task of mastering the posthumous journey certainly made good sense for somebody whose main symptom was pathological fear of death. C.G. Jung and the Universal Archetypes. In holotropic states, we discover that our psyche has access to entire pantheons of mythological figures, as well as domains that they inhabit. According to C.G. Jung, these are manifestations of primordial universal patterns that represent intrinsic constituents of the collective unconscious. The archetypal figures fall into two distinct categories. The first one includes blissful and wrathful beings embodying various specific universal roles and functions. The most famous of them are the Great Mother Goddess, the Terrible Mother Goddess, the Wise Old Man, the Eternal Youth, Puer Eternus, and Puella Eterna, the Lovers, the Grim Reaper, and the Trickster. Jung also discovered that men harbor in their unconscious a generalized representation of the feminine principle that he called anima. Her counterpart, the generalized representation of the masculine principle in the unconscious of women, is the animus. The unconscious representation of the dark, destructive aspect of human personality is in Jungian psychology called the shadow. In holotropic states, all these principles can come to life as complex protean appearances, condensing in a holographic fashion countless specific instances of what they represent. I will use here as an example my own experience of an encounter with the world of the archetypes. In the final sequence of the session, I had a vision of a large, brilliantly lit stage that was located somewhere beyond space and time. It had a beautiful ornate curtain decorated with intricate patterns that seemed to contain the entire history of the world. I intuitively understood that I was visiting the theater of the cosmic drama, featuring the forces that shape human history. I began to witness a magnificent parade of mysterious figures who entered the stage, presented themselves, and slowly departed. I realized that what I was seeing were personified universal principles, archetypes, that through a complex interplay create the illusion of the phenomenal world, the divine play that the Hindus call Leela. They were protean personages condensing many identities, many functions, and even many scenes. As I was watching them, they kept changing their forms in extremely intricate holographic interpenetrations, being one and many at the same time. I was aware that they had many different facets, levels, and the dimensions of meaning, but was not able to focus on anything in particular. Each of these figures seemed to represent simultaneously the essence of his or her function, as well as all the concrete manifestations of the principle they represented. There was Maya, the magical, ethereal figure symbolizing the world illusion, Anima, embodying the eternal female, the Warrior, a Mars-like personification of war and aggression, the Lovers, representing all the sexual dramas and romances throughout ages, the royal figure of the ruler or emperor, the withdrawn hermit, the facetious and elusive trickster, and many others. As they were passing across the stage, they bowed in my direction, as if expecting appreciation for their stellar performance in the divine play of the universe. The archetypal figures of the second category represent various deities and demons related to specific cultures, geographical areas, and historical periods. For example, instead of a generalized universal image of the Great Mother Goddess, we can experience one of her concrete culture-bound forms, such as the Virgin Mary, the Hindu goddesses Lakshmi and Parvati, the Egyptian Isis, the Greek Hera, and many others. Similarly, specific examples of the Terrible Mother Goddess could be, besides the Malakulan pig goddess described in the previous example, the Indian Kali, the pre-Columbian serpent-headed Coatlicue, or the Egyptian lion-headed Sekhmet. It is important to emphasize that these images do not have to be limited to our own racial and cultural heritage. They can be drawn from the mythology of any human group, even those we have never heard about. Particularly frequent in my work have been encounters, or even identification, with various deities from different cultures who were killed by others or sacrificed themselves and later came back to life. These figures representing death and resurrection tend to emerge spontaneously when the process of inner self-exploration reaches the perinatal level and takes the form of psycho-spiritual rebirth. At this point, many people have, for example, visions of crucifixion, or experience an agonizing identification with Jesus Christ on the cross. The emergence of this motif in individuals with a Euro-American background seems to make sense, because of the important role Christianity has, over the centuries, played in Western culture. However, we have also seen many powerful experiences of identification with Jesus during our holotropic breathwork seminars in Japan and India. They occurred in individuals whose background was Buddhist, Shinto, or Hindu. Conversely, many Anglo-Saxons, Slavs, and Jews identified during their psychedelic or holotropic breathwork sessions with Shiva or Buddha, the Egyptian resurrected god Osiris, the Sumerian goddess Inanna, or the Greek deities Persephone, Dionysus, Attis, and Adonis. Occasional identifications with the Aztec deity of death and rebirth, Quetzalcoatl, or the plumed serpent, or one of the hero twins from the Mayan Popol Vuh, were even more surprising, since these deities appear in mythologies not generally known in the West. The encounters with these archetypal figures were very impressive, and often brought new and detailed information that was independent of the subject's racial, cultural, and educational background, and previous intellectual knowledge of the respective mythologies. Depending on the nature of the deities involved, these experiences were accompanied by extremely intense emotions, ranging from ecstatic rapture to paralyzing metaphysical terror. People who experienced these encounters usually viewed these archetypal figures with great awe and respect, as beings that belonged to a superior order, were endowed with extraordinary energies and power, and had the capacity to shape events in our material world. These subjects thus shared the attitude of many pre-industrial cultures that have believed in the existence of deities and demons. However, none of these individuals perceived their experiences of archetypal figures to be encounters with the supreme principle in the universe, nor did they claim to have gained an ultimate understanding of existence. They experienced these deities to be creations of a higher power that transcended them. This insight echoes Joseph Campbell's idea that deities should be transparent to the transcendent. They should function as a bridge to the divine source, but not be confused with it. When we are involved in systematic self-exploration or spiritual practice, it is important to avoid the pitfall of making a particular deity opaque and seeing it as the ultimate cosmic force, rather than a window into the absolute. Mistaking a specific archetypal image for the ultimate source of creation leads to idolatry, a divisive and dangerous mistake widespread in the histories of religions and cultures. It might unite the people who share the same belief, but sets this group against others who have chosen a different representation of the divine. They might then try to convert others or conquer and eliminate them. By contrast, genuine religion is universal, all-inclusive, and all-encompassing. It has to transcend specific culture-bound archetypal images and focus on the ultimate source of all forms. The most important question in the world of religion is thus the nature of the supreme principle in the universe. In the next chapter, we will explore the insights from holotropic states of consciousness regarding this subject. 3. The Cosmic Creative Principle. O landless void, O skyless void, O nebulous, purposeless space, eternal and timeless, become the world, extend. Tahitian Creation Tale. What is soundless, touchless, formless, imperishable, likewise tasteless, constant, odorless, without beginning, without end, higher than the great stable? By discerning that, one is liberated from the mouth of death. Katha Upanishad. Absolute Consciousness. After we have had direct experiences of the spiritual dimensions of reality, the idea that the universe, life, and consciousness could have developed without the participation of superior creative intelligence appears to us absurd, naive, and untenable. However, as we have heard, the experiences of nature as ensouled and the encounters with archetypal figures are not in and of themselves sufficient to satisfy fully our spiritual craving. I therefore searched in the reports of the people with whom I had worked for states of consciousness that were perceived as reaching the ultimate frontiers of the human spirit. I was trying to find out what experiences would convey the sense of encountering the supreme principle in the universe. People who had an experience of the absolute that fully satisfied their spiritual longing typically did not see any specific figurative images. When they felt that they attained the goal of their mystical and philosophical quest, their descriptions of the supreme principle were highly abstract and strikingly similar. Those who reported such an ultimate revelation showed quite remarkable agreement in describing the experiential characteristics of this state. They reported that the experience of the supreme involved transcendence of all the limitations of the analytical mind, all rational categories, and all the constraints of ordinary logic. This experience was not bound by the usual categories of three-dimensional space and linear time as we know them from everyday life. It also contained all conceivable polarities in an inseparable amalgam, and thus transcended dualities of any kind. Time after time, people compared the absolute to a radiant source of light of unimaginable intensity, though they emphasized that it also differed in some significant aspects from any forms of light that we know in the material world. To describe the absolute as light entirely misses some of its essential characteristics, particularly the fact that it also is an immense and unfathomable field of consciousness, endowed with infinite intelligence and creative power. The Supreme Cosmic Principle.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.